from the top. Hit it!
Behind every great human being is a great story.
There's a lot of people saying a lot of things.
And no place knows that better than Hollywood.
The things they make up.
Since the very beginning of the medium, biopics have been a favorite genre of the film industry.
That's such nonsense. I would never say that.
What makes filmmakers return to the biopic again and again?
You think you're ready for that, man?
What makes a biopic great?
Wish we could just make our own movie.
That's a great idea.
This is How to Make a Biopic.
Action!
Before we begin, don't forget to subscribe to StudioBinder and turn on notifications to stay in the know on all our filmmaking videos. Let's get started.
Okay, let's go.
Biopic stands for biographical picture. It refers to a movie which follows the life or portion of the life of a notable person. Today, some filmmakers wince at the term, associating it with formulaic storytelting. As Quentin Tarantino has put it, they are just big excuses for actors to win Oscars. It's a corrupted cinema. And yet, some of the most celebrated films ever fall into the biopic genre. By and large, great biopics take unique approaches to the non-fiction story they are telling, balancing the responsibility to stay true to a person's life, while also taking creative liberties. Director Marielle Heller explains.
It's always a tricky thing because you want to be true to the essence of the person entirely. And you want to feel like if their loved ones saw the thing you're making, they would recognize that person within the movie. But you also have to be truthful to the narrative that you're telling, and you have to find a way to make a compelling movie.
You know, death is something many of us are uncomfortable speaking about. But to die is to be human.
So how does one make a biopic that won't get the ire of Tarantino?
What are you doing?
Let's begin with writing.
I've written myself into my screenplay. That's kind of weird, huh?
Unsurprisingly, writing a biopic requires lots of research, but it also requires a keen insight into what makes your subject interesting. Why should the audience care about this person? And why should they watch a movie about them rather than read a Wikipedia entry?
What did he say?
For Andrei Tarkovsky, the answer lies in finding the larger themes within a person's story. Universal elements that an audience can grasp onto. He explains the larger message in his biopic, Andrei Rublev.
И смысл его гения, в общем-то, заключается в том, что он в самое тяжелое для народа время сумел выразить для того же народа нравственный идеал, выразить его мечту о брате, о единении.
Some of the hardest decisions in the writing process for a biopic is deciding where to begin and where to end, since a movie can only cover so much of a person's life.
And that's the f***ing truth.
For Danny Boyle, the best biopics don't try to stretch from cradle to the grave. He describes his approach to 127 hours.
It wasn't like a life story from the beginning to end or skimming along. It was an intense experience of one event as a way of looking at somebody. And I think it's a more interesting way of doing it.
An effective biopic may also choose to focus on one element of a person's life.
What's that like, you know, to have all that exposure?
Which can help create a more focused narrative.
To have something so intimate stolen from you, it's devastating.
In Bright Star, writer-director Jane Campion decided to focus on the love story within John Keats's life. She describes realizing this was the way into his story while reading his biography.
I think what really affected me was the part in the book where it came to the love story. And I was not expecting it because up to that point, Keats had been pointedly unromantic. So when he met Fanny, it was sort of exciting because he wrote to his brother about her and also sort of described her in a kind of unflattering way. And I thought, oh my God, this guy is not regular.
She has sharp teeth. She sunk her fangs into my poor poem and shook it apart.
A writer must also decide how they want their subject to function within a narrative.
Did I adequately answer your condescending question?
Aaron Sorkin explains the character type he decided on for Mark Zuckerberg in The Social Network.
I really did become interested in Mark Zuckerberg as an anti-hero and writing him without judgment. The way you have to write an anti-hero is if they're making their case to God why they should be allowed into heaven.
When dealing with larger-than-life figures, most screenwriters find it important to find a way to ground them as real people.
Never met anyone like you.
Sofia Coppola found this necessary for Marie Antoinette, who is typically caricatured as a decadent and vicious queen.
Yeah, I was struck by how young she was. She was this 14-year-old kid. And just reading about the side of this real person who had a lot of sympathetic qualities as well as flaws, that she was very human.
What's the matter?
Your mother has died.
Hayao Miyazaki took a similar approach to his real-life character in The Wind Rises, trying to take them as they were and understanding the time they had come from. Once the writing is complete, it's time for arguably the most controversial element of a biopic. Casting a biopic is difficult. Often, an audience knows what the public figure looked like or how they behaved. So a director and actor must strike a delicate balance between getting the subject's likeness and behavior correct, while also avoiding a simple impersonation. When casting Nixon, Oliver Stone chose Anthony Hopkins because he could give the infamous figure more depth.
You see, Nixon was oblique. You never could read into Nixon. You never get past the eyes, the real Nixon. And what the beauty of actors, of course, is that they can play that, but at the same time, they allow you to look in. And that's what Hopkins does.
My friends call me Mr. President.
And so shall I.
In Oppenheimer, many historical figures had to be quickly established. To achieve this, Christopher Nolan opted for bigger-named actors who would immediately make an impact.
The Russians have a bomb.
You recognize them as a great, distinct talent, and you have these people come in, they don't necessarily have a lot of screen time in the film, but you remember them, you recognize them, and you recognize their sort of contribution to the overall. And that was very important to the feel and the makeup of the ensemble.
David Fincher took a similar approach in The Social Network, utilizing the pop star Justin Timberlake to capture the essence of the charismatic Sean Parker.
I'm an entrepreneur.
You're unemployed.
I wouldn't say that.
What would you say?
That I'm an entrepreneur.
I needed somebody that Jesse could look across a restaurant and see and go, that's how you do it. Like, that's how you walk into a restaurant. That's how you handle being the center of attention.
I'm Sean Parker.
How do you do?
You must be Eduardo and Christy and Mark.
Sometimes, however, a recognizable face can be distracting.
Do you have a problem with me?
Especially if they are supposed to be embodying a real-life person.
Here I come to save the day.
The
This was Milos Forman's feeling when he worked on Amadeus.
Mozart, I wanted to be unknown face, because I wanted people to see Mozart and not XY actor, how he plays Mozart, you know?
Of course, when casting, much is made over how much an actor physically resembles the person they are playing. But sometimes a director will opt for an actor's ability to capture the interiority of a character rather than their looks. Michael Mann did this when casting Russell Crowe for a 54-year-old in The Insider.
Russell Crowe is
Australian. He's 33 years old.
Right.
He's not American. He's not from the Bronx. We read 2-3 hours, and I thought this is going absolutely nowhere.
It allows for the nicotine to be more rapidly absorbed in the lung and therefore affect the brain and central nervous system.
We hit one scene. It's a scene in which Russell learns that the interview he taped is never going to air. And he's lost his family to speak out. And as he said, I'm never going to see the light of day.
The public airing of that, the testament to why I did what I did, you're telling me it's not going to see the light of day.
He just sunk. I felt the inner annihilation of this man. And in that moment, sometimes as directors, you know when you know, and I just knew that this is it.
Todd Haynes took this approach one step further, choosing multiple different actors to portray Bob Dylan. He explains that he chose Cate Blanchett as one of the performers to emphasize Dylan's subversive gender presentation during a specific time in his life.
He was this live wire, this incredibly skinny figure, and the hair had gotten bigger, and he couldn't sit still, and he developed those eccentric gestures and the face rubbing, and the fingers would fly off the keys of the piano in these flourishes, the way Cate shows you. And there was a strange androgyny about it that must have been like nothing anybody had witnessed before in pop culture.
Just like a woman.
Once an actor is cast, they will typically do extensive research into the person they will be playing. Sometimes this means meeting the person himself.
You pulled it off so beautifully.
Oh, thank you.
Richard Linklater and Jack Black took this route for Bernie.
Room service.
Linklater acknowledges this isn't everyone's preferred method.
Some actors want to meet the person they're based on, and some don't. Sometimes a director will say, I don't want you to. And Jack was like, yes, I want to meet him. So we went there. And
you cannot have grief tragically becoming comedy.
Sometimes these meetings can give an actor more direction than a director ever could. Co-director Jimmy Chin describes Annette Bening's research with Diana Nyad and her friend Bonnie Stoll, which was the emotional core of the film Nyad.
I think that the real work was the work that Annette did with Diana. She spent months not just hanging out with Diana, but also hanging out with the real Bonnie. She was also able to really kind of understand and see what that friendship was like between Diana and Bonnie.
I love you. I love you too. Come on, one more stroke, babe. Just one more. You got it. That's it. That's it. Power.
Co-director Chai Vassarelli comments on casting Annette Bening as Diana Nyad and her commitment to the role.
It always had to be Annette Bening. I mean, the role was meant for her. Annette's commitment, like she trained for a year. If she was gonna play it, she was gonna do the work.
Two ankles out, yeah.
With the film cast, it is time to look at shooting the biopic.
And cut!
Like with writing, shooting a biopic requires research and a keen attention to the balance between fact and dramatization. Ava DuVernay discusses navigating this tightrope walk while making Selma.
This is a movie. This is a film. I'm not a historian. I'm not a documentarian. I am an artist who explored history and what I found, the questions that I have, the ideas that I have about history, I've put into this project that I've made.
May I have a word with the major?
different directors lean more toward artistic license or more toward faithful documentation. This can extend to a film's aesthetic.
Alvin, you're gonna get blown off the right off the road. That's what I'm afraid.
David Lean's Lawrence of Arabia is a high watermark for biopics that use cinematic spectacle to enhance the storytelling. And for Malcolm X, Spike Lee took a similar approach in order to create a sense of grandeur when depicting the activist's work.
The very first meeting I had with Warner Brothers, I said, this is a 3-hour film, we're gonna need $40 million, and this film has to be in the scale of the David Lean pictures, Lawrence of Arabia, Dr. Zhivago, Bridge River Quiet. I always saw it as an epic.
Because if I was an American, the problem that confronts our people today wouldn't even exist.
That's right.
Now we ain't Americans, huh?
Steven Spielberg, on the other hand, explains why he went for more gritty cinematography in Schindler's List.
I took an approach of a documentarian more than a David Lean approach, which I love quoting and taking in my films, because I wanted the experience to be a personal experience and not really seen through the eyes of a camera.
The trains arrived and the people were driven out with clubs. They were lined up in front of two big warehouses. One was marked cloakroom and the other valuables, and there they were made to undress.
Stylistic elements can also be used to capture the essence of a subject.
Hello, neighbor.
Marielle Heller describes her experimentation in A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood.
There's sort of this surrealist element where the whole movie is set up as a big episode of Mr. Rogers for adults. And it reminds you at once of how kind of trippy the show was at times, but also how connected and emotional it was.
Sometimes when somebody is sick, they have to go to a hospital.
I hate hospitals.
Stylized visual ideas can also help externalize a character's interiority. This was at the forefront of Josephine Decker's mind when making Shirley.
There was a lot to dig into in terms of how do you represent their subconscious and the way that they're seeing each other and their world around them. There's another aspect to the film, which is Shirley is a writer, and there's her process of writing is inside the movie, so at times you go into sort of seeing what she's imagining in her writing. So it meant that there were many layers of reality.
For Paul Schrader, the work of the author Yukio Mishima affected the diverse theatrical styles of his biopic.
Since he was also a man of theater, having written a number of plays. And so that's how it fell out. We had three types of styles cross-hatched with four phases of thought. And that is a very unique solution to a very unique life.
Details about a character can also come from extensive visual research. Lin-Manuel Miranda explains how research affected production design choices in Jonathan Larson's apartment for Tick, Tick, Boom, highlighting Larson's never-ending curiosity in spite of his meager financial status.
There's the wall of books and the bend in the shelf, which is a detail we found from this extraordinary video Julie Larson gave us of Jonathan filming his own apartment for insurance purposes.
For Steve McQueen, the specifics of the real location shifted his approach to 12 Years a Slave.
Once you're in location, actual in the plantations as such, things take on a different form, because not just because of the architecture, but because of the heat, because of the smell. All of these things contribute to something which could never be formulated on a page. It actually transforms the film or the idea into something real.
To Solomon. Cheers.
Cheers.
Visual research can pertain to more than locations. For The Grand Master, Wong Kar-wai carefully studied how Kung Fu looks.
You have to think in terms of a visual. That's why we spend so much time on the road to doing interview with different masters from different school. It's not just talking. Actually, I have to get them to do demonstrations. And when they show you the demonstration, you just look at the move, you understand the move, what is the mechanisms of the body and how to do this fight, and then it's in your mind already because you already have the shot.
There is no one kind of biopic. The genre can be as groundbreaking or as formulaic as any other genre.
The wrong kid died.
Both the subject's life and the filmmaker's vision will influence just what form it takes.
You're gonna have to give him a moment, son. Dewey Cox needs to think about his entire life before he plays.
Have a life story in mind that's perfect for a movie. Start your own biopic with StudioBinder's screenwriting software and add your visual research to a mood board. And remember to subscribe and click the bell to watch all our videos. Until next time, live a life worthy of a biopic.
I've been scorned and slandered and ridiculed too. Had to struggle every day my whole life through. Seen my share of the worst that this world